Okay. So today we will talk about inter-thread communication. We'll make it a bit more bigger. We'll talk about inter-thread communication. You very well know about what is a thread. Now, inter-thread communication means communication between threads. It is used to allow synchronized threads. Usually, inter-thread happens with the help of synchronized threads. Synchronized threads to communicate with each other. To communicate with each other. Now, there are several methods in which you can do inter-thread communication. We will be learning that today. Now, there are three methods. You call them wait, you call them notify, and notify all. Okay, W is small, N is small. Okay, you call them wait, notify, and notify all. All of them are methods. Okay, now wait means you cause the current thread to release the lock, and wait. It causes the current thread to release the lock and wait. Now this waiting, it can happen in two scenarios. One is it can wait until a specified time is elapsed, like you do in your sleep. Okay, until a specified time is elapsed, or until another thread calls notify or notify all. So these are the two ways in which you can wait. One is either for a specific time or until and unless another thread calls the notify or the notify all method. Now, notify means you wake it up. Somebody has called a wait. The thread is waiting. Notify means you wake up the thread. You wake up the thread that is waiting. Somebody was waiting. You wake up the thread that was waiting. Now, notify all means you wake up all the threads. All the threads that were waiting. Hope you're understanding the difference. Notify means only a specific thread is woken up, notified, made awake, and given the monitor. Notify all means you wake up all the threads that were waiting. Okay. Now, we will see about what is called a producer-consumer problem. I believe in operating system, you have learned many. You have learned producer-consumer, you have learned bounded buffer, you have learned cigarette smoker problem, you have learned bakery algorithm. Okay. Now, today we will see how you do the producer-consumer. Producer-consumer and the bakery algorithm, they go almost on the same lines. Okay. I did tell Dixon and Reetha to remind all of you to learn producer-consumer and come. Okay, now, today what we'll see is how you will do the producer-consumer problem with the help of inter-thread communication. Okay. Now, before we go into the producer-consumer problem, the implementation, I'll quickly revise what is the producer-consumer problem. Producer, you can consider it to be a thread or a process. Consumer also, you can consider it to be a thread or a process. Producer goes on producing items. Consumer goes on consuming or using the items which the producer will produce. Now, when you're implementing the producer-consumer, you can have a queue which you can treat as a virtual buffer. You can treat this as a virtual buffer. So this is the place where the things which the producer produces, you are going to store. Okay, now look here. Now the producer has consumed four items. The producer has produced four items and you have put them in your virtual queue. Now, what can the consumer do? The consumer can take it from the virtual buffer and then use it. Now, imagine the consumer needs two. The consumer needs two, which means, you know, two will be taken from the buffer. Okay, at that point of time. And now imagine the consumer needs three. The consumer needs three. Now your virtual buffer has only two, which means, you know, now there is a conflict happening. So usually what happens is, whatever the producer is producing, the consumer will consume. So this is actually a very ideal situation. Producer produces one, there is one in the virtual buffer, and then the consumer consumes it. Okay, so now everything is nullified. Okay, next what will happen? Producer will again produce, he will put it in the virtual queue, and then consumer will consume this particular one in the virtual queue. Okay, now what he has produced has gone, the virtual queue is now empty, and he has finished consuming. Again, the producer will start producing, he will put it in the virtual queue, and the consumer will consume it. So this is what is an ideal situation, when there is a communication between both the producer and the consumer through a virtual queue. Okay, now let's say, what will happen if there is no communication? What will happen if there is no communication between the producer and the consumer? Now, there are many problems which can happen. Okay, first problem is, consumer can try to consume even though, just a minute, okay, the consumer can try to consume even though producer has not produced. Okay, this is one problem which can happen. Consumer wants to consume something, but, you know, producer hasn't produced anything, there is nothing in your virtual buffer. This is one problem which can happen. Okay, another problem which can happen is, producer can go on producing. Producer can go on producing even when the buffer is full. Even when the buffer is full. Like, you know, such a condition. I'll show you. Okay. Now look here. I now have a buffer of 5. Producer produced 5. Okay. Which means, you know, I have all these full. Okay. Producer went on producing, the virtual buffer is full, and the consumer is not consuming anything. Now, even though the buffer is full, okay, after the fifth one, let's say the producer is producing 2 more. The producer is producing 2 more, and my buffer, it's got only a capacity of 5, which means, you know, the extra 2 produced over here are waste. Okay, the 2 produced over here goes waste. The 2 extra produced, it goes waste, because, you know, consumer is not consuming. So these are the main 2 problems which can happen if there is no communication between the producer and the consumer. Consumer can try to consume even though producer has not produced. Producer can go on producing even when the buffer is full, and the consumer has not consumed. Okay, so these are the 2 problems which can happen if there is no communication between the producer and the consumer. So that is why I told earlier, the producer can be considered to be a threat, and even the consumer can be considered as a threat, which says, like, you know, producer produces one, he put it in the queue, and then he waits. The producer is now going to wait. The producer is now going to wait until the consumer consumes. once the consumer consumes it, the consumer will notify the producer, yeah, I have taken it. Okay. So when the consumer notifies the producer will start producing the next one. Okay. He will put it again in the buffer queue and he will wait. He will wait until he gets a reply from the consumer. The consumer will consume it and then he will notify the producer. Yeah, I've consumed it. Please produce your next one. So the producer will go on producing the items. Okay, you have a, you will be having two threads. One is the producer and the consumer thread. Okay, now we will have, let's say, a class called item or a queue or whatever. Now, you should have a flag, a Boolean flag called, let's say, produced, to check whether the producer has produced or not. Let's say initially, the producer has not produced, which means, you know, produced is false. You will have two methods. One is a method called produce and the other method I'll write over here. Let's say consume. You'll have two methods called produced and consumed. Okay. Now, because you are going to do inter-thread communication, this should be synchronized. Your produce should be synchronized and even your consume should be synchronized, because you're going to do inter-thread communication. You will be calling inside your wait and notify. If you want to call up your wait and notify, things should be synchronized. Okay. And now I'll write my code. If produced, that means if it is false. Okay. If nothing is there, if nothing has been produced, you'll have to first, let's say, wait. Before you use the wait, you can only use it inside a try catch. Try wait. Try catch. Okay. The code, we'll write it later. We'll first finish off with the pseudo code. Okay. You are making it wait and now you are going to produce. Let's say you are planning to produce, let's say, int x. So you're assigning now I is equal to x, small I is equal to x. Okay. You are now assigning, which means you have now produced. Once you have produced, you make it true, which means, you know, you have produced something and you are notifying. You are notifying to the other process that you have produced. Okay. Now here also, let's write some code. Okay. Now here you are going to consume. Now here it will be the reverse, exactly the reverse of this. Okay. So I'll just copy paste all this. Okay. Now, when do you consume? You consume when it is true, which means, you know, if not produced, if it is true, you will be doing a try, wait, catch, and then you need not produce over here. You are automatically consuming it. And then you will write produced is equal to false and then notify. So this is how the produce and the consume pseudo code works. No, these, they communicate between each other. These methods, they communicate within each other. They do inter-thread communication. You write a wait over here. You write a wait over here, which means, you know, please make this wait. And then you produce it. And then once you've produced it, you will notify it over here. Once this person gets a notify, it consumes it. And once it consumes, it gives back a notify to this particular method. Okay. So these methods, they are communicating with each other. Now what we will be doing is we will be making these as threads. We will be making these as threads and then writing the program. Okay. So now, yeah, I've just copy pasted everything. Let me just correct my font because, you know, it was in Word. Everything went. Okay, caps and all that. Let me just correct my code. Boolean produced synchronized voiced produced int x. If try wait catch if try, these are the problems when you copy from Word. Wait catch, I'll just intent them. If produced try catch notify. Okay, synchronized consume. If not produced, try. Please mute everybody. Please mute. Catch produced notify. Yeah, okay. Catch what? Yeah, I didn't write all that. Catch interrupted exception. Catch interrupted exception E. System dot out dot print ln E. Okay.
Okay. Class in the brackets are missing.
Okay, yeah, I missed a bracket. Hope it's fine now.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. Now, let me create threads. Let me create threads. Before we create threads, I'll write my public. I'll write my main program, okay? Or I'll create my threads, otherwise I won't be able to write my main, okay? So I'll create a class producer extends thread, okay? Class producer extends thread. I'll have a constructor. I'll write the code, finish off the code, and then I'll explain. Okay. I'll create an object of my virtual buffer. Okay. QQ is equal to new Q. I've created an object of my virtual buffer. And now I am going to create my threads. Now, producer P is equal to new producer Q P dot start. P dot start. Okay. The same way I will be even creating my thread object for the consumer. The thread object for the consumer. Consumer, let's say C. Okay. C is equal to new consumer and then C dot start. Okay, so that's it, my main. What should happen when I do P dot start? When I do P dot start, I should be producing. I should be producing. So I'll simply give int I is equal to, let's say, 0. And you know, you go on producing while true. How much do you produce? Okay, you have a method called over here, dot produce. Okay, when it is true, you go on producing. You go on producing, let's say one item, I++, that is enough. For the time being, we are producing just one item. Okay, so when you start the producer over here, you call up the run, and in the run, what is happening? Okay, I did not want that int. Yeah, I should have had I is equal to zero. I am producing one item while true. So by default, you will be going on producing. Now, when you call C dot start, consumer start, consumer's run will happen. Now, when the consumer run happen, what should you do? You should be calling this particular method, the consume method, or you should consume, okay, while true, the same code, while true, okay, all what you're going to do is, just like you did over here, q dot consume, whatever is made, you are consuming it. So that's it, my code. Okay, now I'll save my program. I'll compile my program.
Ma'am, yes. Command prompt kaanunnilla.
Okay, just a minute. Yeah, see, the error was like, you know, when I wrote this return I wrote inside the if. But you know that return I, it is actually the return for this particular function. So it should have been over here after the bracket. Okay, so that was the error. We'll save the program. Okay. Yeah, we'll run the program. Now look here, we'll run the program. Okay, I'll just press the control C and get the output. Okay, now look here. Look here. We just take a random thing. I produced 38, 34. Okay, I go on starting from one because, you know, beginning I gave I is equal to zero. I'll take any random output. Look here. Produced 37, 78 and I consumed 37, 78. After that, I produced 79. I consumed 79. After that, produced 80, consumed 80, produced 81, consumed 81, and so on. It goes in a very synchronized manner. You produce one, you consume that. You produce the next one, and then you consume that. Because, you know, there is a communication between the threads. Okay. Now, let's see what will happen if there is no inter-thread communication in my program. What I'll do is I'll just take off all the wait and notify. Just a minute, let me take my program and then take off all the waits and notifies. And I'll save it in another name called PC wrong. Okay, PC wrong dot Java. Hope you can see my screen, Kiran.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, now all what I've done over here is I've taken away, here was my PC correct. Okay, where you had all the synchronized void, produce, try, catch, wait, notify and all that. Now I'm having my PC wrong where, you know, I do not have any wait and notify. I just took away all my wait and notify. Remaining the code is the same. I did not do any change to my code. All what I did is I took away this try, wait and notify. Okay, let's run the program. Let's run my wrong way of implementation and see what is the difference if you have no inter-thread communication. If you have no inter-thread communication. Okay, I'll just take a random. Where there is both produced and consumed.
Okay, now look here. When you do your program, you can give a sleep so that, you know, you get a times slot of 1 second in between each thread coming up. Now look here. We'll go here. Okay, look here. Produced 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, which means, you know, in my buffer queue, I've got 833, up till 833. Let's say we'll check from here. Let's say we have got 10 items, 20 to 33. But now look what happened over here. You consumed 33. 33 was produced. You consumed 33. But look here, 33 is again consumed and consumed and consumed because, you know, it is illogical. 33 should have been consumed only once. After that, 33 is over. Like, imagine you have a muffin with you. You have a cupcake with you. Once you finish eating it, you cannot eat the same muffin again. It is over. Okay. But what is happening over here is you produced 833. You consumed 833. And you are consuming the same muffin again, and go on. You go on for some time. You go on consuming it. Yeah. Okay, I'll run the program again. Okay, look here. See, again. Consuming of the same 22008. Look here. You consumed up till 2189. And then you started producing from 90 up till 2208. And then you consumed 2208 for long. But you have never consumed 90, 91, 92, 93. All these go as waste. And the same 2208, you are going on consuming, which is illogical. I'll take my program back. Okay. So this is the same program which we did without the wait and notify. I just took off from my PC, correct? I took off this particular statement and this particular statement, and I named it in a new thing called PC wrong, and I tried executing it. Okay. So this is what you mean by inter-thread communication.